Today at Jawahar Bhavan, and we are here for an event at from Rajiv Gandhi Foundation and FXB Suraksha regarding human trafficking in persons. And we have with us Anuradha Shankar, who is an IPS officer and ADG of MP Police. How any girl like of 20 years old, how can they escape and perhaps take some steps as youth in this era, like in this all problem of human trafficking? What would you be the suggestive measures, like the first 5 steps perhaps, very brief?
See, the first thing is be aware. You should know that it is happening, that there are people who can actually trade with you. I mean, they can just trade you. You can be a commodity for them and you can be sold or bought. So that is the first thing that you should be. You should have awareness. Number two, you should have, everybody has a mobile phone, especially girls like you, you know, who live in cities. They have a mobile phone. You should have some quick calling numbers on your mobile phone. And you should have, you should tell those people who are you, whom you have put on quick calling, that they should take your quick call. And if there is someone is persistently following you, stalking you, or trying to, to push you into an unpleasant situation, then you should immediately inform that person. It's also a good idea to keep dial 100 handy. And so that's the third point, that I personally feel that you must trust the police. Police everywhere will respond when you call them. There's also that you also have every state police has their women's helpline number, and you should have that number with you. So these helpline numbers. So and then spread awareness. You must also make your society aware, your parents, your relatives, your friends, your classmates. You should make them aware and then do something. Get associated with people who are doing something for anti-human trafficking. I think these are the 5 points I would.
What kind of a role does police play? Like, we have heard of some cases in the newspapers that are all coming up that, okay, the police is also involved in such kind of rackets. So what do you have to comment about that?
See, as I said when we were discussing, that the police also comes from the society. So there might be some bad eggs, but that doesn't mean that the whole department is bad. And if the police was not trusted by the people of this country, then the policemen would not be so overworked. You know, the police is the most overworked government department.
Yes.
And that is because people trust them. People come to them. The police station is the only office of the government which is open 24 hours.
Right?
You can go at any time. So just try it. Most people who abuse the police are people who have never gone to a police station.
So what do you think is the role of the administration which it should play right now?
See, the good thing is that things are changing because of this new awareness about even police rights. Now, for the last couple of decades, police housing is improving slowly because, you know, we are not a very rich country and police is not the most priority department. So, but still housing is improving, training is improving, and sensitization trainings have come for the last maybe a decade or so. So slowly in the new batches, the younger generation of police personnel are different from the older generation. Yes.
So how can we expect from personnels to be that committed towards these causes? Because these are ranging causes which are very important. But how do we train them, so to say, like with that psychoanalytic training, or what do we do about it?
See, we have started in Madhya Pradesh, and many states of India have started it, is that we have started making psychometric profiles of our officers and seeing what exactly do they need. So we'll have need-based counseling also for them. But sensitization trainings are trainings where it is a kind of with immersion technique, you know, you're put into that position and creating empathy within the police personnel. So these training techniques, very modern, very well-researched training techniques, in which when you immerse yourself in a situation, you realize what the victim is feeling, you know. Mm-hmm. If a policeman has, through role plays and enactments, mm-hmm. and so these new trainings are having an impact. And we are also doing an impact study. Okay. All our trainings, we are also doing an impact study.
Okay. When we are talking about human trafficking particularly, so it is very much existent, perhaps 70%, as I've heard about the figures, which is online. So when we are talking about it being organized as such, it is a grapevine network. How do we tackle on going through a grapevine network? One solution particularly being that we need to be aware, the youth has to step in, there has to be a sort of a movement generated around it. But then the people, like I'm a 20-year-old girl, a person wouldn't, like a 20-year-old normal, so to say, quote-unquote, person wouldn't be able to, he or she or they are not equipped to fight with such a cause.
I mean, it is like, you know, this violent extremism, even in human trafficking, virtually everything other than the physical act of trafficking is done through the internet, either through social media or WhatsApp, Facebook, and there are various, obviously, there is also the dark net.
Right, the dark web.
So part of it is that government agencies must play a bigger role in monitoring and policing the internet without getting into anybody's freedom of speech. Okay, because human trafficking, unlike extremism, cannot be seen politically as somebody's right to say something, because here some actual exploitation is going on.
Right.
There is no defense of freedom of expression involved here. So certainly there's a great role for surveillance. We are a surveillance society in any case. So there is no reason why various agencies, cannot use the surveillance techniques that are already available through the large search engines to track. So that is one response. The other part I say is that as individuals, today it is much easier to raise your voice because you are able to use your cell phone or a website to get your point of view across.
It is an era of citizen journalism.
Not just citizen journalism, citizen activism. Now, part of it is that in citizen journalism also there can be excesses and you know, you can report it in a wrong way. But the way I see it, and the phrase is often used, is 4 S's, see something, say something. That becomes very important. And trafficking is something we have to gear ourselves to spot. So I think with the right amount of orientation through college textbooks, university seminars, we should be able to see how we can spot trafficking. And after that, it's between you and your cell phone to raise your voice.
The first question also comes about the legal binding. That these people, they are actually the defense mechanism, so to speak, is killed. Like when a person is transited from one place to another, by a trafficker, so what they do is they kill the defense mechanism. They take their passports, they take their ID cards, and they deprive them of any identity. So how can any person, like since you have an experience, how can any person, any common person, individual, can help them out by... somehow, but not them not even having an identity card, so to say.
So you are really talking about the modus operandi. And see, in the case of human trafficking, there is no one defined modus operandi somebody would be adopting to, you know, get hold of the victim. So like one of our model, you should read about it, we call it Suraksha Prevention Model. And this we did it in the past in Jharkhand, which was cited as one of the best case study by UN in the UN Indigenous Committee. You know, we are implementing the similar program in Manipur, which is one of the vulnerable source district. Now, the aspiration you cannot control. You know, and I think as in youth, we all should aspire. You know, you are aspiring, so as me. You know, but we have a different horizon to which we want to achieve or reach at. Now, we are promoting how do you migrate safely, you know. So the youths who plan to migrate and reach out for any A or B grade cities in India, either for education or for better job opportunities, they have the right to do it. But what we are doing, we are supplying a piece of information with them, asking that if you land up in any problem in Delhi, you know, Manipur and Delhi, you know, now there is a 2-hour flight, you know, otherwise earlier it takes more than 24 hours, you know, and by train you not be able to reach within 3 days. So the point that if you land up in any kind of problem in Delhi, whom you should contact. Who is a trustworthy person whom you need to ring up, you know? Because if you reach out to somebody in Manipur, you know, there may be a different kind of hue and cry, and you may not be able to receive those kind of services. So we started offering them a kind of migration card, okay? And this contains list of phone numbers for different cities. So we had devised and looked at which are the cities where they are migrating, you know? And we don't wanted to bring any kind of punitive action around this. So we find out, okay, it's Rajasthan, Bombay, Chennai, Delhi, Bangalore, you know. So we got a list of phone numbers meant for women who are in problem, or children, those who are in problem, any police, any organization, any individual's number, so that you can reach out to them. Now, there is a definitely, because that's part of my classroom lecture, how do I teach, let's say, paramilitary or police, that how do somebody control or develop control over the victim, you know, and these are one of the methods. But definitely, somebody was saying today, you know, you have to speak up, you know, you cannot keep on, so you cannot keep on, you know, that this is my fate, you know, I was born in such and such situation. And that's why equally it's our and your responsibility, how do you reach out to such community, reach out to such vulnerable group, and make them aware that there are services available for you.
So also in discussions of these kinds, like when we have events actually of these kinds, so I have observed it on an individual level that the representatives of the government perhaps have this saying that, okay, the NGOs and the self-help groups, they play a very important role. They play a very important role when the administration is perhaps not working as shown in the statistics. So since you are in fact working in the same industry for so many years, what do you think that what is something which has to be expected from these groups or the NGOs or the self-help groups or the community groups from the government themselves?
See, I mean, this binary is very you know, interesting, and this will not have a solution in a day or in a year. You know, it has to go in time and continuum. The idea that A, both of them need to recognize that they had to work in hand. Like for me as an NGO, I know I cannot work for the issues without government support or without converging with the government programs, which we do it. So we are partner with the Government of India. We run 1098 helpline number for Noida, for Manipur, you know, which is a 24/7 helpline number for children in distress. At the same time, how government is also engaging organization, taking their input, which is a process in continuum. It's not that it's not happening. Like today we have another event going on by UN Women, UNODC, and the Ministry of Home Affairs, where civil society group from across India, as well as you know, representation from the government, as well as from Nepal and Sri Lanka, they're sitting together and talking about human trafficking. That's happening right here, you know. So the idea that it's something you have to take everybody in count, you know. So again, ecological model, which I said, you know, it has to have an organizations who are working on the issues, take them into account. Government definitely, because see, it's just that government have everything on papers. Everything. You count a problem and they have a solution. But the issue with us, you know, how we see that it is equally been translated into actions. And that's where organization like us has to pitch in, join hands, you know, and work towards the common cause.
Thank you so much, sir. That will be on my part. But for the end note, if you could just tell that how can the youth or any person for that matter can connect with FXB India Suraksha and perhaps get some more insight and work towards.
Thank you, you know, and that's what makes us more delighted and excited, you know, and probably I said that maybe this is not the end, perhaps not the beginning for us, but we want this engagement to happen more fruitfully, and there is more, I would say, warmth between the relationship, you know, and it should happen from both ways, you know, and we are available, you know, we can reach out to our website through in the social media, and wherever you think that you need more information, clarification, because see, we don't want to spread wrong information to perpetuate and develop a perspective about it, you know, and that's what one of the play talks about it, right? Now, which is so important to break those perspective, develop a perspective or a vision where you think that how important you are. So we want reach out to us, invite us for a discussion, conversation, because unless this conversation and dialogue is not happening, I don't think we'll have a solution.
I had to ask you about the significance of this particular day, of having this day as the day of the event for with FXB India Suraksha and as a collaborative of Rajiv Gandhi Foundation and the British High Commission. So if you could tell me about the more relevance of the day, and particularly the date, because that was being circulated around.
Yes. In the whole, yes. So you see, this date, any day that is observed has its significance. The reason is that is one particular day that the world chooses to bring awareness and to bring knowledge and insight on that particular issue, right? Human trafficking, so far, there are organizations that are working on it. There is of course government legislation. All of this is happening in isolation. There is no such, you know, large nationwide movement that we see around, jaise environment ke saath hai ya HIV AIDS ke saath tha. Yes? So that is the significance to observe the day. Okay, now the reason FXP associated itself with this day is because FXP has a program called Mukti, which is an anti-human trafficking program, and that is running in the northeastern states of the country, particularly Manipur and Meghalaya. Okay, so this is a very core intervention area that we are very, very passionate about. Mm-hmm. The other thing is that our collaboration with British High Commission has been because of British High Commission's own interest and in observing the day. This is a UNODC initiated day, the United Nations Organization on Drugs and Crime. Mm-hmm. And our partnership with RGF dates back to, you know, many, many years back. Mm-hmm. So it was very obvious that we would partner for this because they work a lot with young minds, and we work with on human trafficking with young minds. Mm-hmm. And hence we came forward and we came together and we wanted to just have the day.
Right. And today we had a slam poetry event, then we had a youth dialogue. Apart from that, we had two short plays. One was from the children from Rajiv Gandhi Foundation itself. Yes. So what do you think were the set milestones, since you were the communication and research officer and you were the program person. So what do you think were the milestones particularly for this day, and how important were, like how much these milestones were achieved,
yeah,
perhaps?
Yeah. So, too early for me to say what milestones were achieved, but not at all early for me to say that now FXP will be collaborating with individual colleges of Delhi University and also Amity University to now have a continuous dialogue on human trafficking, on child sexual abuse, on forced labor, and then to make it more active through student participation. If you saw Narita, the student participation was immense, and right, you know, they were not prepared students. I mean, of course the plays were prepared, but the students who came in for youth dialogue, those questions were very impromptu. Those questions, I felt the students were asking, thinking from the heart and not thinking from the mind.
Right.
Yes? I want to take this energy forward. As an organization, I'm very sure that my organization will support me in taking this energy forward. So we already have adolescent clubs running, which are formed and catalyzed by my organization in Manipur, two districts, Okhrul and East Imphal. So we form student clubs, then we give them issues on human trafficking to discuss, and then they come up with their own ideas of how to combat it. They make it a student movement. They've already made one. We have 22 such clubs running. Okay, in Manipur. And then it spreads to other parts of the community. It could be their parents, it could be the community, the village, the churches. So that's how this is exactly what we want to have in Delhi.
Right.
Yeah.
So you're actually like having a vision of a kind of student activism, so to say, if that is the correct term for it.
Yes. Right. Yes, however cliched it may sound, yes,
student activism. Right. So there was also a very interesting discussion in the youth panel in which I was a part of as well. So there was this thing that this has to come up as a movement. So if we have to talk about the current issues, there was LGBTQIA+ and all of those things, and then they came upon as a movement. Then it was passed in the Supreme Court, and obviously we achieved a lot of difference now. Mm-hmm. If we range back to the past year, so about the movement building thing, how do you think that can be worked upon?
Continuous engagement with the youth. Continuous engagement. We cannot put an end to, it doesn't have to stop at observing the day, right? So when you say, how do you think we can propel this forward, I'd say NGOs like FXP, and there are many other organizations like FXP which are working on human trafficking, they need to come together, they need to brainstorm with students, because, see, we may have experience, but the freshness of ideas that comes from students, yes, is unparalleled. And I think this is how it'll go, bit by bit. It will take time, Narita. There will be setbacks that we will face, undoubtedly. But it will still grow. If this momentum, if what I saw at the program hall today is even 20%, you know, of the complete energy that students have. I think we can really, really start, and we can start well.
Right. So, and also since you're beginning with the students from Delhi University, so obviously that is, and Amity, of course, so that is obvious itself a very great pool of students who are actually studying a lot, and they can actually contribute a lot to those ideas. But apart, right, the questions they ask particularly. Apart from that, what about the other institutions, right? So if they, like the students from there, have to sort of collaborate and perhaps even like be a part of this initiative, so to say, how can they do that with FXB India Suraksha?
So they're most welcome, Narita. We have a volunteer base. They can come in as volunteers, they can come in as interns for any period of time that they want to. And not just FXB, any organization, you know, whose cause, social cause, they are very close to. As far as this particular issue is concerned, human trafficking, there are other organizations. They can join, and even if they don't, let's say, join regularly with a particular organization as a volunteer or as an intern, within their own college, they can form clubs. Right, they can have you know, the lovely street play that we saw this afternoon, this morning. They can have initiatives like these, dialogues, you know, and dialogues even with institution heads, and then you know, it can spread as an inter-college thing, and they can just start with just bringing this issue to the forefront. Remember this, it's a, what does it say, third largest organized crime.
Right.
It's a shame,
third largest organized,
it's an absolute shame. Not in this century, no. Yeah.
Apart from that, it being existent more on the like web, how do you think it is, like how can we tackle it? Because when 70% of the crime, and the, like since it is an organized crime as we just spoke, so how can we tackle it with the help of our initiatives? Like student activism is a thing, it is obviously on the ground level, but when it comes to the web thing, obviously the administration has to enter in, and they are the ones who can actually do something about it.
Yeah.
What can we as students do? Can we report some cases? When, can we do something about that?
So by web you mean cybercrime?
Yes.
Mean So, okay, two things. One, when we say technology is misused in the case of human trafficking, because that's a new strategy that human traffickers have employed, technology can also be used to combat human trafficking. Yes? How do we do that? We can do that through social media. Yeah? One, a few hashtags, and I know hashtags may sound very flimsy, you know, are hashtags se kya hota hai? But there are times when Me Too started as a hashtag. Yeah, we have an example. So this can come in as a, you know, as a social media movement, one part. How can we report cases? Yes, students can report cases. The numbers that were given, 1091, 1098 for Child Helpline, 1091 for Women Helpline, 181 for Women Helpline. These are places where a common person can report cases. And then you can follow up. There is no, you know, stopping to that. Yeah.
And what do you think is the first basic step? Like from my side, individual aspect, I think it's acknowledgement of the presence of this issue, because people obviously view it as a very distant kind of an issue, not close to them, not closer home. So how do you, what do you think are the next important steps of initiating action around it?
So acknowledgement, I think people acknowledge that yes, there is human trafficking, but as you said very rightly, when we read in the newspaper, we think ye to kahin aur ho raha hai. It's not going to affect. And also we read it as a pact, as a piece of news. Padh liya and we move over to the next page. How do we, what are the other steps that we include? The first is to relate to it. You've got to relate to it, and you've got to be aware. You've got to understand the signs of human trafficking, which is very important, for which you need to have workshops. What do I mean by signs of human trafficking? I mean, you're traveling in a bus, you're traveling in a train, anywhere, any public mode of transport. You see something fishy, right? You see a girl who's very, very nervous with a man who's very vigilant. Why is it like that? You know, normally when we travel with our own people, we are very relaxed. Now, that is a sign that you need to catch. Probe the girl. If you cannot, just report it. You have these helpline numbers. Report it. You know, so these, so the, what I'm saying, when I say relate to it, this is what I mean to it. Be aware of your situation. There's nothing much that students can do as far as the legal aspect is concerned, as far as legislation is concerned, judiciary is concerned. What can you do? You can actually take care of the surrounding around yourself, and you can make an impact.
Thank you so much, Charu. That will be on my part. So report, acknowledge, not only acknowledge, actually be aware of your surroundings, report it to the numbers which we have told you, which are rightly, if you could just repeat the numbers.
So we have 1091 as the women helpline number for women in distress or for women you think are being trafficked. There is 181 for the same purpose. And then we have 1098 as a children in distress helpline number.
We are a global media philanthropy project in collaboration with Dainik Bhaskar, Nagrik News, News 24/7 Entertainment, and Nagrik Foundation.
Mm-hmm.